living God, the God of the Bible, the Ancient of Days himself, the one who is trusted and trustable. He's a strong and mighty breasted one. I want you to please have that in your mind, that we are not gathered to philosophy, we're not gathered to science or intelligence, we're gathered to God. And it's important that this is the house of God. I need to say that again, because sometimes we forget and we sometimes take the liberty to just, you know, flow the way he's doing us. No, there's a way to come into God's house. There's a way to conduct yourself. There were people who, when they don't connect themselves right in God's presence, God was at liberty to strike them dead. As of old. And before you say it's Old Testament, Ananias and Sapphira were dead for just saying that they are keeping their money. So I don't want us to lose it. And sometimes we're always looking for literal death to prove it is God. No. Sometimes other things can die in you. That is not how Ananias and Sapphira died, when you don't behave yourself right. There's a way to conduct yourself in God's presence. He's the mighty God. He's the one that the whole world bows to. The King of Kings bowed to. So sometimes, because he's not physically appearing here with cloud and smoke and thunder, we sometimes, you know, need to remind ourselves. And in the simplicity of spirit, where we try to create sufficient liberty for the word of God to have free access, we try to make it as easygoing as possible. And I want us to please also, as in that same simplicity, carry the consciousness that this is God. Amen.
Amen.
On the other hand, and I'll be sharing about that very shortly, about the importance of also becoming God's friend. I want you to know that if you're not careful, we'll think that God just wants to be a father or a God. I am of the opinion that God wants friendship. The Bible calls Abraham God's friend. At some point, Jesus stopped and says, I no longer call you servants. I don't even call you brothers. He said, I call you friends. There's a stage you get to where you can call yourself a friend of God. And I want us to aspire to that stage.
Yes,
and that stage is not for the celestial. It's not for the dead. It's for the living.
Yes, sir.
It's for the living. I want to invite you to that consciousness that you can be God's friend. Sometimes when we talk about God, the only thing that everybody thinks about is the seriousness of someone that should be saving us. God too wants to laugh with you. God wants to have relationship with you. God wants to eat with you. God wants to just literally listen to you. I don't think some of us will remember that God is really looking forward to friendship with us. So that your Christian journey will not be too fatiguing. I promise you, friendship is what will sustain it. Friendship with God. The Bible says friendship with the world is enmity against God.
Yes, sir.
You remember that's what the scripture says in 1 John 2. So I'm trying to draw your attention to the power and potential of us being God's friend. That means that we also know what he likes. I don't want us to just fear God. I want us to also love God. Amen.
Amen.
When we are talking about love, believe me, God is conscious about the importance of the person you love. Fear is casted out from. In fact, the word of God says perfect love casts out fear. Am I correct?
Yes.
The word of God casts out fear. So I don't want us to come trepidating in front of the Almighty God. I want us to also feel like we are loved and that we are loving him back. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Tell me, ask your neighbor, do you feel loved?
Yes.
Get an answer, please. Ask the person, do you feel loved?
Yes.
You feel loved. I feel loved. Right, so I want us to get the balance. Amen.
Amen.
While we know that we are gathered to the Almighty God, I want us to be balanced about it. Now, don't forget, we're all workers, you know, members of the church. The teachings I'll be teaching this month will be geared towards working, getting results, finishing strong, you know, faith, taking responsibility, and other related conversations as such. Is that okay?
Yes.
I want us to please do me a favor, be part of the story, let your mind apply to it, okay? Let your spirit embrace the discussion. Are you listening, please?
Yes, sir.
Now, I also know that we're all at different levels of understanding and different levels of mindsets, all right? I want you to have a mindset here. Are you listening?
Yes,
that I'm a child of God. Being a child of God doesn't mean you are perfect. It's an invitation to the life of God. And what I've learned from scriptures is that we can be taught the ways of God. Okay, I'll be getting into that very shortly. So let's try this scripture from Luke chapter 7, verse 36. We're going to read down to verse 42. There-ish. Let me double check that. We're going to read down to verse... verse verse 48. So it's a long one, like 12 verses. All right, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Should we read together? I read alone, or someone will read for us. Abi, how does it work? Okay, let's read together, ba. Okay, let's read together. Everybody, we are read. Let's do this together, okay? Yes, Heavenly Father, breathe upon what we're doing tonight. Amen. Let your name be glorified.
Amen.
I have spoken with you before now. Give evidence to our conversation.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
And let's go. 1, 2, go.
Then one of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him, and he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to eat.
Okay, let's go on.
And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrance oil, and stood at his feet behind him with weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears, and wiped them with the hair of her head. And she kissed his feet, and anointed them with the fragrance oil. Now when the Pharisees who had invited him saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is, who is touching him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answered and said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. So he said, Teacher, say it. There was a certain creditor who had two debtors, one owed 500 denarii, and the other 50. And when they had nothing which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more? Simon answered and said, I suppose the one whom he forgave more. And he said to him, you are rightly judged. Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrance oil. Therefore I say to you, her sins which are many are forgiven, for she loved much, but to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. Then he said to her, your sins are forgiven.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Do you like the reading? Very interesting. What do you take from that learning? There's a lot to learn in that scripture.
Yes.
There's a lot to learn. First of all, somebody invites Jesus to his house. Jesus came. Jesus was sitting down. One sister who came along with perfume, alabaster box, the Bible calls it, broke the box and used it to wash his feet and started to wipe the feet with her hair. If they do that for man of God today, the man of God is in trouble. What do you think? Insta-blog. Insta-blogger. It's not unique anywhere. Then they were washing the feet. Then the man that hosted him said in his chest, so he didn't say it out, said, if this man is really a prophet, this man I invited, have I not made a mistake? If he's really a prophet, he should know that this girl is a sinner. Eh? He should know that this girl is a sinner. You call somebody else a sinner. And Jesus not argue. Jesus not argue. I want you to listen.
Yes,
and then he said, look, you, I want to ask you a question. You know, he used parable to talk to her. And said, somebody was, two people were owing the same person. One was owing more than the other one. The one that was forgiving more, both of them were forgiven. He said, who do you think will love more? He said, I'm the one that was owing more. He now said, you have judged rightly. This is the part that blew my head. He now started counting his offenses. So that means if the woman did not do anything and the guy did not think anything, it was not an offense.
Yes.
What I'm trying to bring out from there is that what you are doing might be wrong, but Jesus is not talking. Because it was until Jesus started, so he had all that in mind. I'm seated there, you did not give me water to drink.
Yes, sir.
I'm seated there, you did not wash my feet. I'm seated there, even kiss, he was looking for kiss. He was sitting there. But I'm not the one that said, you people are. Somebody's trying to imagine that it's not kiss, that Jesus is K-I-W, you saw it, kiss. And so he says, holy kiss, spiritual kiss. He said, and guess what he was kissing? She was kissing his feet. That's amazing. Are we listening?
Yes, sir.
But you see, the point I want to bring out is that Jesus did not talk until the guy was misbehaving. I said, look, you could have watched what she's doing. You did not do. You did not give me water. You did not give me towel. You did not give me oil. You did not give me anything. And you're complaining about somebody else who is demonstrating his love. You know, some of us are like that. Somebody else is outdoing you and you're complaining. Instead of focusing that I could have served like that, you are focusing that this person is not only overdoing, but a sinner. You are seeing the person's sin nature and trying to use it to placate what you are negligent of. You are seeing the person's negligence or shortcomings as a justification for why you are who you are. And while that is not even where I'm going to tonight, I promise you, I want to show you that there are many things embedded in that scripture that reflects and reveals, number one, the person of Jesus Christ. Write it down. Very important. That reveals and reflects the person or personality of Jesus Christ. Number two, it reflects the principles of Jesus. The principles of Jesus. Number three, it reflects the power of Jesus. Because after that, you see him say, I have power to forgive sins. Verse 49. We didn't go there. Because after that, he said, thy sins are forgiven thee. That's in the next verse. So we said the person and personality, the what? The principles. Number three, the power. Number four, the purpose of Jesus. In that same scripture, because that woman was anointing him, preparing him for his death. So we have the person and personality, the purpose, the principles, the power, and the purpose of Jesus there. You know, very important conversation there. Now, I want to show you something. Now, you know, I have said before that in your Christian walk, there are four things. There are three that I mentioned that time, but there are actually four that I have found out. And the part I did not mention then is what I want to mention today. You know, I have said before that don't joke with your finance, your health, and your eternity. You saw it in that video. Yes, it's still the same me talking. But I want to add one more to it. Don't joke with your purpose. You see, because your purpose is what will make your eternity meaningful. Your purpose is what will make eternity meaningful. And so tonight, what I want to talk about is taking responsibility for your purpose in life. That's what I want to talk about. We're going to be talking about taking responsibility for your purpose in life. If you read that story on, for the sake of time, I may not go there, or if you can just be sliding it down, you will see how the Bible says that she came and anointed him, and then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven thee. And after that, he said, and then those that sat at the table with him began to say, who is this one who is even forgiving sins? Next verse. Then he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. If you are not just a, go in peace. All right. Now in the it says in the John chapter 12 version of this same scripture, that is the John narrative of it, I think it's in John 12, the Bible says that, and there is nowhere Jesus, this gospel we go to, that this woman's name will not be mentioned. Do you remember that story? Yeah. Jadi, do you remember? The way you're looking, you don't remember. You're just remembering drugs. So what I realize is the power of what that woman did. Are you listening to me?
Yes,
recently, I've been attending a class. I just did an exam for my Bible training college stuff. And one of the things I really appreciated in that discussion was that there are people who have served God in this world that when they were, I'm not talking about Bible, I'm talking about real people that have served God in this our time, that when they were serving God then, they did not know that what they were doing was significant. Do you see what I'm trying to say? They did not know that what they were doing was important. For example, this woman now in this case, when she was doing it, she did not know they would write it inside Bible. I don't know if you see what I'm trying to say. There are things that we do that we think we just did and was small, but ended up becoming significant things in history that made us great. For example, did you able to fetch that scripture in John? It should be 12. Is it okay? You gave us Mark 14. Okay, Mark 14 is good. Actually, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her. That means Jesus is saying anywhere the gospel goes to, that the validity of what this woman has done will always be carried along. Whether she just did it, not knowing the consequences. I don't know if you get what I'm trying to say.
Yes,
it was just a reciprocation, or it was English, just an expression of her love. A very innocent action. Please, are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes,
please?
Sir.
If you want me to say amen, please.
Yes.
Okay. So it was a very innocent act of faith. She just came in, broke the oil, and started doing it. Did not take permission. There was no precedence. No pastor had done it before. Nobody had said, you must sow seed. Nobody influenced her. Out of the abundance of her love, she broke. The Bible says that when they narrated that perfume, they said it was worth a year's salary. I wanted to just think about buying a Creed Aventus. Creed Aventus is small, because Creed Aventus is not your 1 year salary. Maybe now it has gone more, because it used to be 200 and something thousand before. You know, it's about £142 or something like that. You know, at some level, you will know that, okay, this thing is not a joke. That's some figure. Am I making some sense? There's another one like that is very terrible on the shop stands. People don't go there often. The bottles are full. You know, there are some perfume stores. I'm not even talking about Nigeria. When you are passing the airport, as free as they put sample, people don't touch the sample. You will have fear to touch it. I don't know if you, when you see perfume bottle, £404, what am I looking for? But the point I'm trying to bring out to you is that that perfume that she broke was a year's salary perfume. What perfume do you want to buy for 1 year's salary in one bottle? Lubotu. One bottle, yes. In fact, the Bible calls it a box. I just imagine, because I know perfumes. I like perfumes, if you don't know. I like perfumes a lot, you know. So what I know is that to get that kind of perfume, Omo, it was probably your biggest treasure. It was probably as good as a share stock or something.
Yes, sir.
That kind of a thing that you know that this is my best. This is my best. Now, what did Jesus do for that woman? Let me tell you some of the things Jesus did for her. Jesus casted out a devil from her. Yeah? Jesus healed her. The Bible says of whom went out 7 devils.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same Mary. Alright? She was a friend to Jesus' mother. Alright? So that kind of relationship, and Jesus Christ casted out devils from her, helped her, you know, become wholesome, become acceptable. People literally took it up, because that is different from Mary, the sister of Martha. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? Because there's Mary and Martha, that is different. Some people think they're the same. My study feels that they are different. I don't have absolute terms to it, but from what I studied, it appears there are 3 Marys in scriptures. One is Mary and Martha, Mary the mother of Jesus Christ, and this sister Mary. This is the Magdalene. You see, because that womb went out 7 devils.
Yes,
okay, so are we together?
Yes, sir.
That's why Mary is a very powerful name. Anyway, so what I'm trying to do here tonight is to show to us that at some point, God is not going to ask of you what you want to do in reciprocation. He's going to expect you to demonstrate your love for him in personal response to the way you judge best. And then he said something. He did not condemn Simon. No. He just said, you love me, but somebody loves me more than you. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. He said, why? Because her sins were more. Her sins were more. And she deserves, she has received more forgiveness. And based on that, she's reciprocating. And what I realize is that some of us have not gotten to the point where we truly value what Christ has done for us. Maybe we didn't sin enough for him to forgive us enough. Maybe you've never entered depth enough, because Jesus Christ is not talking about sin to illustrate his point. He used depth. And that's what we owe. Sin is a depth. Sin is a debt you owe. That's why they sing that song that we pay the price, he did not pay, he owed the price, I did not pay. You could not owe. Christ Jesus, needed someone to wipe my sins away. Are you getting my point? So what that does is that the sins we commit is a debt. It's a debt. And that's how Jesus Christ wants you to take the forgiveness of your sins. If you listen to the Lord's Prayer properly, he said, most translations says, forgive us our sins, forgive us our trespasses. Some scripture says, forgive us our debt. Yeah, I don't know if you noticed that. Forgive us our debt, as we forgive those who are indebted against us. What am I trying to say? Is that the sense of indebtedness you have towards God will determine the flow of love you show towards him. I feel a lot of us don't feel indebted. You're not conscious of what God has done for you in Christ Jesus. So it is, so to speak, truncating the expression of your love.
Yes, sir.
When they say you should do something, it looks like it is tedious, because you are not putting it side by side his love for you. If you think about the days they could have roasted you as chicken meat for ritual, the day they would have rolled you on the floor or kidnapped you for free. You know, those are things God expects us to take consciousness of. Now, they're forgiving your sins. You can as well forget that you were once indebted. I used to owe before, you know. And I mean, some people used to have 40 apps that were calling them before. 42 to be precise. So their sense of gratitude, when you see them express it, you think that what is wrong with you? Maybe you too need to owe 42 apps before you know it. But I don't think that is wisdom.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Maybe because he also could choose to forget. There might be somebody who was even owing 56 that has forgotten. It is, God is counting on you to stay conscious of his love forward for you, to be able to demonstrate his, your own love towards him.
Yes,
please, do you guys get what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
And the good thing about that is that the Bible says that eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has he entered into that. What God has prepared for those that love him in turn. I can tell you from this understanding that when you see a person's love in slow motion, or gradually distilled in very poor manner, it is because the person has forgotten what he obtained from God in forgiveness. And we're not talking about sin, we're talking about the indebtedness, the situation where you know it was God that remedied you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Because it doesn't have to be sin in literal sense. When you know you had nothing, God showed up for you. When you know that there was nothing else in your case or your, and God is saying that that thing that is supposed to flow towards him from you, he is missing it as a sweet smelling savour. That your life should become a living sacrifice based on your understanding of his finished works in your life. And so when we don't demonstrate it properly, we are like that man. Not that you don't love God, but you are not conscious of his forgiveness in your life.
Yes, sir.
And then you look at other people as, what is he doing? What is this one? If it's not you that we know that you are, it's not this you that we know. So let's go back to the discussion I was talking about, how that there's such a thing called the principles of Jesus Christ. What I realize is that at some point we will all be faced with the challenge of balancing our lives. And from my understanding, I've been saying it, I think I've tweeted on it twice in the last 48 hours, about how God is counting on mentoring or mentorship, whatever the correct English is, to be able to pass on value standards across generations. I'll explain. Excuse me. So, what's that? Okay, they say, okay. You know, how God is counting on mentoring for knowledge to be transferred from one person to the other person. Knowledge transfer. Because some things happen in some generation. If you are not a good child of history or a student of history, you repeat the mistakes of history. Am I correct? Yes. So what does God count on? God counts on people who should tell the stories. In the Old Testament, the Bible says that God planned that the people who were parents of the children of Israel should write the story on their door of how they came out of Egypt. He said they should tell their children the chronicle of what happened. Are you listening?
Yes,
Ma, you need to come and sit down in front, okay? You know, so we said to tell the story of what happened. And what they took from it was that they learned very... Are you listening to us?
Yes, sir.
Please don't let something distract you now, eh? It's just try sitting down in front, okay? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, thank you. So he said they should write the story on their door, their wall, their lintels, so that when you get to their door, the child can read it every day, how God saved them from the hand of Egypt. What was that? That was mentoring. Please just follow me. You know, if you see me talking like this, I'm trying to architect that structure, your thoughts. Uh-huh. So that was story, that when you read it, so that every generation will continue to remember what God has done. Because when we don't tell the story, people will forget. No matter how good it is, people will forget. Secondly, when we don't have a mentor to guide us, we will lose that heritage. Mentors are very important. Mentors are significant. There was a story of, let me tell you a true story. My father, let me make a story. When my father passed on, he left us some property that we did not know anything about. Do you know that kind of thing? Hectares. Oh yes, I'm planning to start church there one day. It's not that. Hectares. I did not know I own hectares. I did not know. It was somebody that came out and said, your father owns properties. Eh? In my lifetime. Hey, and I'm struggling here. I said, let's go there. The man knows the mapping. He knows the portion. There are mighty, mighty palm fronds on it. Recently, they brought each of us in family kegs of palm oil. You, am I correct? Mama, Abby? Yes, now. Bear me witness that it's true now. Yes, sir. Kegs of palm oil for each family. They brought it from village. Oh, that's minus the one they have taken, you know, before it comes to you. So they just said, let them send one to us. What am I trying to bring out? It took somebody who knows, to be able to secure our inheritance. There are many things that may belong to us that it's a mentor that will show you the value.
Yes, sir.
Let me give you an illustration. Somebody can be here today now and is born again, and all this born again thing, all this we are talking about, he's just thinking about heaven, how I will enter heaven, how I will enter heaven, how I will enter heaven, and that is all on his mind. But God is saying, entering heaven is not my best for you. Heaven is just one of the very, so to speak, should I use the word, outcomes of your being born again. Are you getting what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
Heaven. No, that's not God's biggest. So another person here is thinking about being holy. Being holy, that what God wants for you, we should be able to stay there. That thing needs to shake up. You know, that just being holy is what God wills for us. I know. Okay, so if she doesn't mind, she can. Is that place tight or? Okay, let's stay there. Let's just enjoy, please. There, allow her, babe. Just let's enjoy the flow. Yeah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, thank you. Are we together, please?
Yes, sir.
I want her to sit in front. My heart, come and sit in front. My heart doesn't want anybody sitting at the back today. Or you bring your chair now. Come and bring your chair. Come and sit. Nothing says you should. Eh? Aha. Okay, there's a seat for you here. Thank you. Thank you. You are sitting on two chairs in your lifetime. Eh? Are we together, please?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So, mentors is what I was saying. Mentors. Everybody says, say mentors are important.
Mentors are important.
Let me ask your neighbor, who is your mentor? You see, the problem about life is that sometimes we are satisfied in just choosing one area of life. Maybe we have an area where we don't need a mentor, then we have another. You know, some ladies don't have a mentor in beauty. So they just do strange makeup that they look like Willy Willy when they get outside. You know what Willy Willy is? No, this is not Willy Willy. There's a real Willy Willy. Abby, do you know about it? There's a real, no, I'm not even joking. No, there's a real Willy Willy. Just Google Willy Willy. You will see what will come out. It's amazing. There was a real Willy Willy. I'm not kidding you. Willy Willy. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Now, hear this. You can have a mentor in one area and be feeling happy you are doing well in just that area. For example, let me be clearer. Spiritually, you can say, I am worshiping God. Now, for some of us, we don't even have a mentor in any area. But I'm giving the illustration now that some of us have even found a mentor, maybe spiritually, have someone to how to pray, how to fast. I want to let you know that you are on a journey in this life. Yes, and how well you're doing well in this life is dependent on how much you know. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Believe it or not, it's dependent on how much. You know, recently, I thought I'd impressed myself. I saw one offer, federal government bond, savings bond, and I bought it, and I was happy. So I was thinking that I didn't miss that offer. So I now called my stockbroker. I said, I've not seen my fund bond that I bought. He said, which of them? I said, I mean, the last one that just came another. He said, it comes out every month. I said, it comes out every month? I thought I'd hit jackpots by getting that. He said, no, it comes out every month. It's not a big deal. I said, it's not a big deal. What I thought it was, to me, it was big deal. You guys might not appreciate what I'm saying until you get there. I thought I had hit, man, Oga. This is coming out. I saw the December one now. It's coming out. And I was like, wow. Not knowing can be costly. Not knowing can be costly. UBA Bank brought out their shares. It's selling publicly at 37 Naira. When I called my stockbroker, I said, I have rights issue to pick up on this UBA. They said, no. Don't buy from them directly like that. That buying directly from the stocks is still selling at 32. They are quoted at 32. I hope I'm not talking above your head. No, it's not. That they are selling at 32. That UBA is quoting 37. That is 5 Naira extra above their real value. I said, just wait. We're not even buying anything again. Just leave everything on the ground. What I'm trying to bring out is that in that sense, this guy might not be taller than me, might not be older than me, might not be richer than me. He's my mentor in finance. I listen to what I'm saying.
Yes,
I will do as poorly as an ignorant rat that I did not consult his opinion.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I will be losing money even though I'm probably older, finer, richer, bigger, more educated than him. It doesn't matter, sir. We all need someone to guide us in this life.
Yes, sir.
Can I hear your amen?
Amen.
We all need it. I'm using myself as an example. I used the property. I've used finance now. On health matters, you need someone to tell you, sir, this is what I suggest. This is what I suggest. This is what, do you understand?
Yes,
and this is what I did. You say, no, it doesn't matter. You know, I told you your finance, your health, and your eternity. Am I making some sense?
Yes, sir.
Who would you call the person that takes care of your finance? Your financial advisor? Or your banker, as the case might be. Who is talking to you about your finance? Okay, who will you call the person that takes care of your health? Maybe your doctor or a friend that is into medical line. Don't forget, you need that. I know you know Bible, but you cannot know enough. When I say don't joke with your health and your finances, I'm not saying you should just have a good conscience. All some people are using to count on how to succeed in life is a good conscience. That is a poor strategy. There is no strategy in God will do it. There is nothing like that. There is no strategy that Lord have mercy. That's not a strategy. There is no strategy in prayer. Are you listening to me? This antidote to failure is knowledge. It's not a matter of God have mercy, Lord, you know I came to church. In that line, no, you will fail if you don't get knowledge. So that scripture is saying, my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. For the lack of knowledge. Properties are going up. Some people don't know how to buy that property because they call it 192 million. You just hands up. Which day would my grandfather ever see 192 million? I'm not interested. But somebody else can tell you, come. How much do you have? How much do you have? The real value of that thing is 192. But if you can have some, maybe 1 million now, hold it down. Hold it down with 1 million. Is it possible? Yes. You are the one that is using 192 million to chase yourself away. What am I trying to say? You will never advance in the purposes of life without knowledge. Your life will move only to the degree of knowledge you have, not the amount of prayer you made. The purpose of the prayer is so that the right knowledge can come to you.
Hi.
Are you listening to
yes,
me?
Yes, sir.
The prayer is so that you will not stay among those that are deprived in life. You see, for example, a sister is praying God for a good husband. Lord, I want a good husband. Lord, I want a good husband. What that prayer will do is that he will set you in front of kings
yes,
and good people. But your behavior is what will justify whether that king will choose you or not.
Oh, yeah.
So it's not a function of prayer. And I want us to know that that act of prayer that we do in church is a spiritual line of worship to know Jesus in terms of his person and personality. But we are missing out on the other side of Jesus Christ, which is his principles.
Hmm.
The principles of God make us enriched on this earth.
Hmm.
The person of God makes us know who Jesus is and who he was, but also make you rich. That's why you can be spiritual but be very broke.
Aya.
Because the road that leads to spirituality is different from the road that leads to prosperity. Please, do you understand that?
Yes, sir.
And I'm saying to you tonight, it is mentoring that cures that problem. Mentoring is the first initiation into knowledge. You can even have knowledge and not know how to interpret it.
Yes, sir. Yes.
It takes a mentor to show you this is the way. Oh, this is the way. Oh, don't go like that. Oh, some of us depend on only Holy Spirit. Even Holy Spirit depends on your teachers.
Mm-hmm.
It says you no longer be far from your teachers, but you shall hear a voice saying behind you, "This is the way to go. Walk in it." Please, are you listening to what I'm
yes,
saying?
Sir.
Somebody is trusting God for relationship, marriage. You came into marriage with sincerity, pureness of, you're even a virgin. Nothing has touched you before. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
You will fail in that marriage if you are not guided on how to succeed in it. Some of us, even if you marry Jesus, who we know is not a sinner or can do any evil, you will still fail. You know why? Because it is not good conscience that wins the battle. It is wisdom. The word of God says, wisdom is better than weapons of war. What does that mean? That means wisdom is better than prayer, because your weapon of war is prayer. Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes,
so today we are speaking about how that you need to take responsibility for your purpose. How that you need to know, first of all, if you're looking for that scripture that says wisdom is better than words, it was always Ecclesiastes 9 verse 18, 16 to 18. Mm-hmm. Just for those that might like to have it. You know, so tonight we're talking about taking responsibility for your life. To say, in other words, if some things are going to change, okay, that's it. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good, okay? So some of us may be thinking that things will change because of time. Listen to me, things don't change because of time. Time is not capable of changing things. Time is not capable of changing things. Time is, so to speak, not capable of changing people. It is what we do with time that will change things. It's not time by itself. Tomorrow will come, doesn't mean anything will change. If anything changes, it's what you did in that time that changed it. So when the Bible says my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, it's not saying that they are destroyed because they don't love me or they are not interested. It's because they are not doing with time what they ought to do with time. For example, your financial posture will not change because time came. A fool does not become wise because of time. A lie does not become truth because of time. Am I talking to us tonight?
Yes,
so what I'm trying to achieve tonight is to draw attention to the responsibility you and I have towards getting that area of our lives that we want to, you know, develop on or grow at. And it's different for everybody. For example, some people have simple issues as little as low self-esteem. They don't even know how to go about it. They just came and met themselves as Christians, and they don't know what to do with their lives. They know someone, when the pastor is preaching, that their heart is, something is connecting with this man. I am getting it. But they don't get, what should I now do? For some, they have, like Pastor Tokes was saying on Sunday, they went, brought their purpose to God and said, "Lord, bless this my purpose." It's like when a sister brings a man and says, this person I want to marry, Lord bless him. Why not ask for his will? Because when he shows you his will, that will is already blessed.
Yes.
Then you go and bring one Frederick Thomason and say, please, Lord, bless this guy. God doesn't just work like that. I don't know whether you want to believe it or not, but I'm your mentor now, talking about your eternity and your purpose. So while you might need a financial expert to speak to your financials, you might need somebody else to speak about your health. I'm speaking about your purpose slash your future, and I'm speaking about your eternity. Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
And those are the four or five things I mentioned: your purpose slash future, your finance, your health, and your eternity. Where you spend eternity is very important, but how you spend eternity is more important. You hear what I just said? Where you spend eternity is determined by your being born again. If any man be in Christ, he is saved. But how you spend that eternity is tied to how you fulfill your purpose. Please, do you understand what I just said?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Because some of us are just satisfied that we know that we are going to heaven, but there's nobody that has come to tell you about the next level. You see, let me give you an illustration. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8 and chapter 19, these two chapters speak to how Paul and Peter had to arrive on the scene to tell the believers about the Holy Spirit. There were people, even in our church time, just since 18 something till 1900s and 21st century, all of that, we had people who, so to speak, resisted the idea of the Holy Spirit. So in Acts 19 verse 1 and 2, you see how Apostle Paul got there and said, have you guys received the Holy Spirit since you believed? Look at their response. Acts 19 verse 2, verse 1 and 2. And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus and finding some disciples, look at his question, verse 2. He said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit? Give me KJV. KJV is how we read it. It's correct, but KJV, is, I want you to see the language in KJV. Do you have it? I want you to, all I was looking for is, have you? That's what I did. That was a did you. It doesn't communicate how I want it. He said to them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Look at the answer. He said, and they said unto him, we have not so much had as any Holy, had whether there be any Holy Ghost. Which one is Holy Ghost again? Now, this was after Jesus Christ had gone. The Holy Ghost had come. This is in chapter 19. Chapter 19 of Acts of the Apostles. This is a long time. Paul was already born again here. And from Bible scholars, that was about some 15 years. There was a Holy Ghost that they did not know. That it took somebody to come and ask them, have you guys received the Holy Ghost? Say Holy Ghost care.
Yes.
Which one is Holy Ghost again? Holy Ghost. How does it look like?
Yeah.
That's what happened. Then he now said, look at Paul's response. He said, so to which baptism were you baptized? Give me this verse 3. And he said unto them, unto which baptism, what then were you people baptized? What have you people been doing? Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
That's how it is for some of us. As I'm talking to you now, some of us don't have anything clear-cut for purpose. But the spirit of excellence that is in the man that is serious about his life, that spirit makes you respond to God when he's leading you with opportunities. So like I said, your prayer will bring you before the king, so to speak. All right, so to speak, in terms of the opportunity. But the king now tells you, go and do something, or maybe go and do a work or something. Please, can you bring that chair forward so that you don't stay alone? Bring that chair and sit beside that Sister Tolani there. I think that's fine. Just stay with Sister Tolani there. Yeah, that's fine. You know? Please, are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
If you are getting blessed here, I say amen.
Amen!
Amen!
I'm hoping that you are finding what I'm saying,
yes,
not just
sir.
Useful,
yes,
but... So we must know how to convert what those spiritual things are. I was using an example just now. What's that? I was saying something. Okay, if I remember. So we must know how to convert those spiritual things, those blessings from heavenly places. The Bible says, blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Is it heavenly places you need them? Is it? Some of us are billionaires in heavenly places. By your faithfulness in church, you have a credit in your accounts as a billionaire. But my dear, you don't need the billions in spiritual places. You need the billions on earth. How do we turn what is ours spiritually into reality? Don't forget what I said to you. The disposition of the man who prays is that the Lord will order his steps. Many of us are stubborn or compromised, or we don't have the right response to spiritual things, because a lot of things in this life depends on your response. If a king or a big man comes to ask a lady out, if the lady doesn't respond, there's nothing he can do. Any attempt to prevail on her because she was quiet will be tantamount to rape. Oh yes, it is the consent. That's why they say it was a consensual your response. So he touched you, you did not say anything, and you went on. Your response, you know, he asked you out, you did not say yes, but you were visiting him. You can't be blamed. Are you getting what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
So your response is not just in yes or no. He bought you a gift, you hugged him, said thank you. Oh, I really like the gift, thank you. You are responding. Our response is what I'm really speaking about, and it doesn't matter to anything. How you respond to God's word will determine how much God's word can do for you. You see, because as I'm preaching now, you know, somebody just thinks that we're talking spiritual things, you know, it's good to be listening to spiritual things. No. What I'm saying is a conference lecture. Now, this is the part I fear for some of us. This message is more effective concerning purpose when people start out early in life. What I have realized from my study and counseling is many people have given up on themselves. They've accepted that it is too late for them to succeed. They feel somewhere secretly the misfortune that of their history, that things cannot really change. So whatever they are listening to is not making the right impact on their hearts. Somewhere in their minds, they've agreed with life that they have failed. Nobody knows it. Nobody is saying it. But I can tell you, I know that feeling. Where you have given up somewhere in your mind. So men, especially those of us that come to church regularly, aside from the fact that you have gotten so used to the messages of life, that at some point, somewhere in the depths, deep recess of your mind, you don't know where to start. You somewhere think it is too late for you to succeed. That's why I said it's your response. It's your response. It's your response. And tonight, I pray that the one who corrects time will correct your history.
Amen! Amen!
I pray that tonight, God will relocate you. Amen. And you will stop taking empty strokes at life in the name of
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen!
So what are we talking about tonight? The first thing you want to get from this teaching, number one, is what I call direction. Write it down. It's a simple word, but it's almost everything I will talk about tonight. And then we pray and we go home. Direction or direction. So where do you start from? You need to come with a sense of urgency. What I'm trying to create in you tonight is a sense of urgency. You know, some of us, I know you may have felt like a failure all life. Life is beating you black and blue. You have never really stood out in life. And so you are almost adjusting to that trend. Some of us are literally doing things that we know are beneath us. And that wrestle for your soul is such that you are afraid to take action because you don't like the way where you are. Fear for some people has paralyzed them. They're not ready to take any bold risk to pursue destiny. And I'm just looking at you wondering if you really ever are a Christian. If you really believe that God is your God. I expect you to take yourself, that's what Pastor Tokumbo said, I can't help but refer to each time. That the way we do one thing is the way we do everything.
Yes, sir.
So even to cook egg for yourself, you can't. Some of us, to feed yourself is a problem. You have so transferred responsibility for life to everybody except yourself. When they take light, you say it's NEPA. When they say it's dirty, you say the broom is on ground. When they say, why is your bed rough? You say it's actually the bed sheet. When they say, why is this door open? You say, actually, it's because the last person that left forgot it, so you did not plan to lock it. You just don't realize that it is you that must take responsibility. Nobody will take it for you, not even the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is called to help us alongside what we are doing. He is not to take responsibility for our lives.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit is a helper of what you are doing, not that he will take over your life. He doesn't do that. So what are you doing? Where are you with God? Do you really believe God is a blesser? Are you really on a journey with him? I'm not talking about invitation to ministry and become a pastor. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about taking yourself seriously with your life. I'm talking about you knowing that you have a place and a purpose in this life, that if you ask God, he will answer you. Look, let me tell you something. I'd rather be number two in God's will than be number one in my own plans.
Yes,
some of us need to stop what we are doing completely. Stop. Just stop. You might even be married. You need to just stop and say, if I have this knowledge now, will I still marry this person? You are in a job. You don't have to die there. You can stop and say, Lord, what is the purpose of my life?
Yes, sir.
The good about purpose is that it does not only help you. It helps humanity. And greater part of it is that it secures your eternity. That's why I don't want you living a life without... See, the good thing about purpose, they call it goals, they call it objectives, they call it vision.
Yes,
the Bible says that when a man is without vision, he's like an unbeliever. Yes, Pastor, how do you know, sir? Proverbs 29, very simple. I think verse 18 or so, or 28, 19. Please double check for me. It should be one of them. That I say, where there's no vision, the people perish. Where there's no vision, is it? I was correct, huh?
Yes,
29, 18. He said, where there's no vision, the people perish. You see that there are about four things that the Bible tells us will make people perish. Number one, don't believe in Jesus Christ. Number two, ignorance. Hosea 6:4-6. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Number three, lack of vision. Number three, lack of vision. And then number four, I write it in my book. Amen. The Bible says, for God so loved the world. Can we finish it?
That he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
That means anybody that does not believe in Jesus Christ will perish. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
This scripture says it's not only people that do not receive Christ too. Anybody that does not have vision will perish. Vision means your purpose for living, your reason for existence. You see, show me a man of vision, I will show you a man of provision. Because provision follows vision. The scarcity, what you are looking for, is inside your vision. The day you find your vision is the day you find where your provision is laid. God does not come to sponsor your own idea.
Yes.
He comes to sponsor his idea in your life. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So I put it to you tonight that there is an urgency for locating vision. Say it again, say vision.
Vision.
Say it one more time, say vision.
Vision.
So if a man will find vision, how will he? How will he? There are four ways to get your vision. I will share with you three. I will make some progress. Okay? Number one, inquiry. You need to ask your maker for your vision. Why am I on earth? What am I here for? Why am I here? Why? What am I doing on earth? This does not apply to any gender. It does not apply. I mean, what I mean by that, it does not discriminate by gender. It does not discriminate by age. Everybody can ask. And listen to me. Don't feel you are too old to ask your purpose. Don't feel you are too old. Don't feel it is too late. Leave that to God to decide. The man of Babalola, let's not go outside the country too much, started at university at age 80. I was in his office. I can't forget when they told us to come and cover him for insurance, 2008. He said he wants to start at university. I said, hey, are you serious? Yes, he said, yes, I'm ready to start. I said, serious? Yes. He said, we should travel to Ekiti. It was my region. and went to go and insure his building when I was working then, a bit of it, not all. It's a big property. What I'm just trying to draw your attention to, people, are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Is begin life with vision. When a man is running with vision, it shows. You see, the power of this vision is that it will make you never perish. Number one, you will never, this perish does not mean go to hell. It means suffer in life. Let me tell you something. Once you find your vision, what you have done is that you have given God a chance to support you. Look, don't think what I, you see, that's what I used to, you know, fight or really fear. Maybe the word is not fight, fear. There are some of us think you understand what I'm saying. You need to go back and listen, because these words will stand against you in judgment. When you show up at heaven's throne, I'm telling you this, the truth, the judgment seat of Christ, because there are two judgments, the white throne, great white throne judgment, and the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ is where we as believers will receive rewards. And listen to me, whether by death or by the return of the Lord in rapture, we will see the Lord. I am saying this to you so that you will not be a cleaner in heaven. Find your vision. Don't think you understand what I'm saying. Go back and check it again. For even I will do the same. Find your purpose. Your provision is inside your vision. You know, the greatest thing vision gives to you is fulfillment. It's fulfillment. You will have a fulfillment that money cannot buy. You have a sense of awareness that nobody can replace in your life. Number one way to find your vision is by asking, inquiry. Have we captured that?
Yes, sir.
Number two way to find your vision is by being busy with whatsoever your hands find to do. You don't have clarity of your vision, keep busy. The Bible says, whatsoever your hands find to do, do with all your might. Number three, join yourself to someone that inspires you and stay there till it succeeds. Let me encourage you that this also can relate to your ministry. Like I said, find your purpose. And in this, you will find mentors. Look, when you find purpose, wherever you walk, you will find your purpose in that place still. You will see that everything works together for your good in fulfilling your purpose. You will understand that God brought you to that organization for a material time, for a specific purpose, in line with your purpose in life. You will find out that you are that voice that speaks hope and courage to some people. It no longer matter how much you earn. It will matter how much you impact. Your impact in this life will make you commit yourself to making sure that you never run dry of inspiration. You know, a lot of us, we wait for others to inspire us. When you find your vision and you are fulfilling it, you will find that you've become the inspiration because you never stay empty.
Yes, sir.
You know, I really wish I can jump inside you and make you do what I'm saying, but so I've said three. All right?
Yes, sir.
What's number one?
My inquiry.
Number two is what?
Be busy with whatsoever your hands find to
do. Number three is what?
Join yourself to someone that inspires you and stay there till you
succeed. That inquiry, are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Is born out of curiosity. And that curiosity should reflect in your inquiry. You know, when you are curious, you keep asking questions. The people you are asking questions will even start getting angry. What is it, Seth? Do you know what I'm talking about? Does anyone? When did you come? Which one is this one? Why did they put this one like this? You ask too many questions. Listen to me. It's your life, sir. You need to ask all the questions you can ask. That's why I feel that some of us are not responding properly to the problems of our lives. That problem was supposed to make you ask God questions in a prayer and fasting. Instead, you have used that to excuse why you not come to church. That last person you were owing was a signal for you to check whether you are doing the wrong thing in life. But you just feel that it doesn't matter. You're still doing it. And your foolishness is repeated. I don't even have a problem with your foolishness. I have a problem with those you are taking along with it. That's where I have a problem. Now, listen. Everything we learn and do nothing about, we prove that we are foolish. And that's why I come with a very strong sense of urgency tonight. Not that you should pray more, but that you should do more. Don't leave this place without doing it. Some of us are, I'm going to say it. Some of us are failures looking for who to take along. And you need to dissociate yourself from some people. Are you listening to what I'm saying? See, when a failure is looking for his partner, I'm telling you, he will stop at nothing but to take one along. And you can see everybody thinking that everyone wants to succeed. I say it again, not everybody wants to succeed. There was one day we preached to somebody, we were preaching on campus. One guy went for evangelism from on campus fellowship. I was telling him that there's a hell. He said, God can't take him to hell. He said he heard that somebody was telling him that when God is very angry, we'll throw him across. Have you heard that nonsense story? Have you heard that story before? I said, God will throw him over. That God will be too angry, we'll throw him over hell, and he will just enter the other side of. So he had a babe inside. So we now say, don't say, I know that everybody are touching, they are going together. See, let me tell you something. You are the one that thinks life is ordinary. And that's what I want to close with tonight. What is your philosophy for life? What is guiding you? You know, some of us are just living every day. Your parents never gave you one. You have been coming to church, you've never listened enough to know that there's a philosophy that informs your behavior. There should be something. You can't just be living life anywhere, bare face, every day as it comes. There must be something that informs your action and reactions. And tonight I'm preferring purpose. Let your purpose guide you. Let your purpose guide you. Now, on that purpose, like I said, when God wants to show your purpose, it's sometimes when you ask him, he will say it through a person, he can show it through a vision, he can use just about anything. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes,
when you read a book, and that's what I realize, a lot of us don't read. A lot of us don't read. We think that this reading is just for passing exams. Unfortunately, I know you live in an environment where the reading purpose was just to pass exam. Mm-hmm. But I'm trying to tell you, it's more than that.
Yes,
it's not the volume we read, it's the value.
Yes, sir.
I'm not talking about, I've read this book, I've read that book. That's not, it's the value. That when you turn each page, you have gotten something. That is how to live. That's why I said this life without mentoring is disaster. Somebody has journeyed this life.
Yes,
that you don't need to start all over.
Yes,
you
yes,
can learn from yes, his sir. Mistakes.
Yes, sir.
Somebody's story looks like your story. Somebody is even yes. worse than you that has succeeded. This discussion tonight is God that sent me
yes,
to
yes,
you.
Sir. Yes.
And he said, I should tell you so that you can rise and your story will inspire.
Yes, sir.
On Sunday, I was saying something. I don't know if you heard it. Some people, if they lay two good alternatives on the table, they will leave the two and go and choose the wrong one.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying. Don't be part of them.
Yes,
don't be part of them.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Don't be part of them. That you are aware that God is trying to lead you. That you know that, okay, this thing I'm doing is not a waste. I can succeed also.
Yes,
I can make the best of my life.
Yes,
I'm not a total failure.
Yes,
listen to me. Somebody has failed more than you. Somebody has done worse than you.
Yes,
but you see, if you don't calm down and know that this thumping is inside a book, you keep running around thinking that it is by effort. When you succeed in this life without, you know, I was trying to say something on Sunday also, that the greatest thing about success, are you listening?
Yes,
look up everybody. The greatest thing about success I've come to realize is not that you made it or you achieved your goal. Is that the way you made it and where you made it from inspires others to make it. Your success must be such that inspires where people thought you were a failure. Now, if you have listened to this message, do you know the right thing to do? Forget about everything that's been in your past and start afresh.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Forget about everything you suffered. Write down the areas of your life you know you are confused about. For example, there is a purpose to your living. Write it down. Lord, what is my purpose? Forget about what you have suffered. Just forget about all that. God starts with us when we are ready.
Yes, sir.
So forget about all that and say, okay, what is my purpose? What am I lacking? What are the areas where I'm deficient? Are you seeing what I'm saying? And then write it out. And then one by one, start. There's so much. You know, I want to tell you something. Somebody is saying, I want to go back to school. It's not going back to school that will make you succeed, though.
Yes, sir.
This, let me just tell you something. Degrees are overrated. They're overrated. I'm going to share a video after now. I didn't want to share it in daytime. Degrees are overrated. You might think, by the time you finish your degree of 4 years, all that you read has expired. I'm not kidding you. For some schools, what they taught 20 years ago is what they are still teaching.
Yes, sir.
You finish and say, well, there's no job. Because if you take the line of purpose, you'll be faster than academics. I want to go back to school. It has not done any significant difference other than the self-esteem of saying, I also have the quality. Fine. And you can do that online. Use purpose to guide your destiny.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to school. I promise you, there are people with degrees like thermometer that have not done anything with it. I went to school, though. I'm even still in school. So I'm not saying, if you can go to school, fine. But if it is about paying your bills, I can assure you, your purpose will do better. Tell me which school some musicians went to. I don't want to mention any particular name. You even forget that they're in school. Professors are dancing to their songs. I was watching Dangote dance to his own. My papa no be Dangote. Did you see that video? Dangote, and he was dancing. Yeah, and the song was saying, my papa no be, that's, this is the Dangote dancing to the song of Tenny. Is it not Tenny, Abi?
Yes.
And that one just open her mouth and sing, and believe it or not, is counting.
Yes, sir.
They illustrate us, especially those of us that call ourselves Christians, we are waiting to climb a ladder of frustration and wonder why God is not guiding us.
Thank you, sir.
And I'm simply saying tonight, find your purpose. Pursue this thing.
Yes, sir.
I truly, genuinely wish that I am showing you enough examples to make you angry tonight.
Yes,
because some people, I promise you, after dinner now, they forgot everything said. Some people don't have the stomach to handle important things. They're not even afraid of those that they will make fail.
Hey,
Do you know how many people will fail because you did not succeed? Alex was telling me when he got to America, I asked him, I said, so did this America blow your head like America? I said, daddy, you prepared us now. We've done UK, we've done Dubai, we've done this, we've done that. So when I got there, I was like, okay, nice. That they were thinking his job would be on the floor. I said, Abba, my dad has exposed me. I said, I thought in my life. I said, I didn't believe it was my son saying that. I don't know if you understand the difficulty I'm still trying to catch up with what some of the things I'm hearing. He said, my dad, I said, which dad? I was checking that. So it was a useful thing for the boy. He got there, he was talking from the position of confidence.
Yes, sir.
Look. Don't set up your child for failure simply because you fail to rise.
Yeah.
When I was saying this thing, I was also very broke. I was never saying it because I had a fortunate father. No. My father, I told you, he told me that if I can't, I should learn vocalizer. I told you the story.
Yes,
what a dangerous man. Just imagine. So don't think it's because your daddy, your bishop, your dad was skinny. I never even knew he had property until he passed. I don't know if you know that kind of father that does not tell you anything he has. If you like, he was never even planning for you people. He never even told us till he passed. You know that? Dangerous man. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Your children don't have to suffer. Except you're not planning to have any. But the journey starts now.
Yes, sir.
It's not too late.
Yes, sir.
It's not too late. Sir. You're going to pray one prayer. That Lord, let this knowledge I have not stand against my judgment. Turn it into a prayer right now.
Yes,
In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
You know, I really want to say this, that tonight, what I shared, I know the people that will get it are getting it from this meeting.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know, sometimes you might have had this message. Like I say, great meetings don't make great people.
Yes, sir.
It is the decisions we make from the meeting,
yes, sir,
that make great people.
Yes, sir.
I pray tonight will help you make a great decision.
Yes, sir.
That from tonight, your actions will be informed and guided.
Amen.
For some people, they truly start the journey, but their energy does not stay long.
Mm.
Let me tell you how to manage such a thing. The way to manage such a thing is find a partner.
Mm.
Find somebody to bond with.
Mm.
When you are serious like that, and you don't want to fail,
mm,
and you know you don't know how to do it by yourself, find a partner. It happens to all of us. When you read in school, and you're not very sure, you rub minds with somebody.
Yes, sir.
Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Some of us even sit with the person.
Mm.
When you forget something, you just say, mobilization, you just remember everything. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Don't look at me like as if I asked the question. But listen to me, that's not a terrible offense.
Mm.
Any real examiner is not looking for that as a query. I mean, invigilated exams. I used to read, and thankfully, Mama was my seatmate. I used to read. We'll read. I'll say, baby. I should say, you damn teacher. Yeah, and we check knowledge. It's okay. When two of you are going together, you find more joy. I was the overall best student. She was the overall best female student.
Wow.
Do you understand what I'm saying? Little wonder. Do you understand?
Yes,
when when they were counting, yes, I did well. We praise God for that. But she was the overall best female. Best female, I said. Eh? I just want to show you, there's nothing wrong with having a friend. Some of you will be having useless friends, even here. Friends that will not benefit you, that will just confuse your life. Every day you are angry with them. Leave them alone. Find somebody that is going forward. Find somebody that means business. Don't just have friends that you gossip with. Have a friend that will show you a new book. Have a friend that will challenge you. That will wake you at night and say, let us pray tonight. Useless friendships that will be sharing nonsense with you. It must end, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
It must end. Don't you think about your family? Don't you think about your future? Don't you think about your eternity? Look, when you are broke, it will look like God is not with you.
Yes, sir.
I'm telling you, sir. I'm saying it. Shebi, I'm your pastor. I'm telling you the truth. You almost wonder where, oh God, show up. So that when money comes, it will look like the money is the God. Are you playing with me? Money? Don't worship it, but don't ever deny you don't need it. I want us to pray one more time. The Lord grants me determination and dedication to follow through this discussion. Open up your mouth and let us pray. Lord, grant me determination. Grant me determination and dedication to follow through, Lord, with diligence, with hard work. In Jesus' name we pray. I pray this is the last time you will ever have this kind of feeling. That from today, the next testimony will be testimonies for you.
Amen.
The last prayer I want us to pray is, Lord, give me the right attitude.
Amen.
You see, all said and done, wrong attitude can finish anybody. You know the right thing, you are serious, but wrong attitude can make you lose favor. I want us to pray. Lord, bless me with the right response. the right attitude, that when I'm hearing things that will make my life go forward, shaping my mind to respond. Let me not respond like a foolish person. Open up your mouth and pray. Lord, shaping my attitude. In Jesus' name we pray. Say that amen like a believer.
Amen.
Put your hand on your head. Say, Lord, from tonight,
Lord, from tonight,
I receive the right spirit.
I receive the right spirit.
The right attitude.
The right attitude.
I respond to your word.
I respond to your word.
I respond to your instructions.
I respond to your instructions.
Correctly from tonight.
Correctly from tonight.
My thoughts are right.
My thoughts are right.
I respond correctly.
I respond correctly.
I say the right words.
I say the right words.
To open the right doors.
To open the right doors.
Lord.
Lord.
Open the doors of my heart.
Open the doors of my heart.
To the knock of your voice.
To the knock of your voice.
Say it again. Say, Lord.
Lord.
Open the doors of my heart.
Open the doors of my heart.
To the knock of your voice.
To the knock of your voice.
I open my heart to you.
I open my heart to you.
Guide me from tonight.
Guide me from tonight.
Let me never fall.
Let me never fall.
Show me the path of life.
Show me the path of life.
Help me, O God.
Help me, O God.
Deliver me from self-indulgence.
Deliver me,
Father, from self-conceit.
Deliver me from self-conceit.
Deliver me, Father, from self-pride.
Open my eyes, O God.
Open my eyes, O God.
Open my eyes, O God.
Open my ears, Holy Spirit.
From tonight,
let my life be turned around.
Let me have the right response
to every area of your principles. Say it again, to every area of your principles that concerns my purpose,
that concerns my future,
that concerns my finance,
that concerns my health,
that concerns my eternity.
I obtain mercy
to live purposefully.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Lift up your voice and make a prayer one more time, giving him thanks tonight. I say, Father, thank you. Hallelujah. Say, Gregetu Braga Shada Badaba Kodobos Masata Gado Dobegetu Bagadadan Rodos Migratoto Bekesusa. Can we pray the prayer tonight? Please, let's lift up our voice in prayer. Holy Ghost. Shatabayadose. In Jesus' name we pray. Before we take the communion tonight, look up. Before I ask you to pray one more prayer, please look up. As a believer, I have noticed, now I got born again 1988. Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
That's some years back. What do you think? That's some good years back. What I learned over the years is that some people focus just on their spiritual life. So they know spirit things, you know, spirit. So when they finish such meetings, their spirit man feels warm. Hey, I felt God today. But when they get home, reality hits them. And they now start to see that it's not spirit they will eat to. When self-esteem blasts them, they tell themselves, oh, more, these spirits, wait first. You see, so there's a portion that I've seen that they don't know how to balance it. You know, I will say something here. Many times I felt under the inundation to say what is popular. I'm telling you the truth. Let me tell you the truth. It's easy for anybody to want to be popular. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
But the Lord has restrained me. Not once, not twice, not thrice, not four times. That young man, say what I asked you to say. Otherwise, you will lose your relevance. Look, what I'm telling you today is the balance of all sides.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
The power of God, the person of Jesus, the principles of God, the purpose of Jesus, that is what I'm sharing with you.
Yes, sir.
So that on all sides, you'll be thoroughly furnished. that your philosophy for living will not be conjured or obtuse or, you know, wrong. You need to be diligent in hard work. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Any message that we preach to you that does not confer on you the responsibility to choose how much of it you get is a false message.
Yes.
If I pour oil on you like this, empty it, and don't give you the chance to choose what you want to do with your life, is a wrong message. This teaching has come out tonight. It's you to determine how much of it will work in your life. You can choose and say, ah, that message, I was blessed. Or you go back and listen and write out what you learned and say, Father, show me something. Show me something. Soon the difference will tell. It's not running around that makes the life beautiful.
Yes,
it's not about activity. It does not lead to productivity. I'm busy does not mean you are in business. I'm absent does not mean you are progressing. I want to tell you tonight, calm down. Don't start with just plugging this message and run. You have missed it.
Yes.
Go back and check. Even if you know what I'm saying, go back and say, Lord, show me my life. Guide me aright. Let me get it right in life. Are you ready tonight?
Yes, sir.
What song are you going to sing for us today?
When the glory comes.
Eh?
When the glory comes.
Good one. Let's take that song.
This is holy moment.
Let's take the song.
When God walks in us.
Let's come around and take the communion, please.
Every age is under the Lion and the Lamb. Say, this is holy moment.
This is holy moment.
When God walks in on us.
When God walks in on us.
And the Lamb. When the glory comes, when the voice is singing,
hey,
oh,
oh,
oh, when the glory comes,
there'll be no words to say.
When the glory comes, one more time.
Say, when the glory comes,
when the glory comes,
there'll be no words to say.
Please put up your right hand. Heavenly Father, thank you for tonight's teaching.
Thank you, Lord.
I ask, Father, for a special encounter tonight for everyone.
Amen.
That this month of December will be one to remember.
Amen.
Help us take responsibility for our purpose.
Amen.
Help us take responsibility for our future and eternity.
Amen.
We ask, Heavenly Father, that this message will serve as an encouragement.
Amen.
And a realignment for everyone.
Amen.
Let a new story begin for everybody.
Amen.
Thank you, Heavenly Father.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' precious name we pray.
Amen.
Please, you can take your seat in God's presence. Hope you are blessed by the teaching. So, you know that Moses started when he was 80. Moses started at 80. At 80. Nobody here is 80, I believe. Your life can be beautiful. and your life will be beautiful in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I said your life will be beautiful in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, like I said, please take out time to stop. Don't just hear this message and run. There's a required action that everyone who is going to benefit from this message must do. And I've told you, go back home and articulate it. Purpose. What is my purpose? Write your name on top. Alexander Omoleye Faranpojo. What is your purpose? Your purpose is to produce a rich supply of God's word to humanity, thereby making humanity better and making eternity worth it. Purpose done. How I do that purpose? How? By speaking on platforms. Everything I do is in line with purpose. When I go for a conference, or I join a body, or I work somewhere, it is in line with my purpose. Your purpose that seeks to secure God's purpose in your life will never make you go away from God. Any purpose that you think is a purpose that withdraws you from your commitment to God is not of God. If you find the day where you say, as an entrepreneur, you are working for someone and you are not able to service your service to God properly, it's not God leading you. I'm telling you, God will never lead you to something that will take you away from Him. That makes very simple sense. I don't need a deep prophet today. God will never take you. So all this nonsense that I'm working, I can't come to church, it is malady of the mind. It is not comprehensible. God's purpose will always give you the chance to serve Him more, not even less. Yes. 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 So this is where the devil has to distract some people. In the claim that they are trying to fulfill their work that is not glorifying God is not God's work. You can be working and earning, but it's not glorifying God. It's not. You must always protect your interest. It's God that brought you to the work. How will He now be losing you because He brought you somewhere? And you see some people spend 35 years serving the wrong thing. You see some ladies, I'm dating a guy, the day they start, they can't come to church again. I'm not kidding you. That the day they said yes, that was the day they last saw the guy. Or even themselves in church. Why didn't you come to church? Actually, my boyfriend was not feeling fine. So I had to go and take him over the night, over the weekend. He was not feeling very well. Is that Aaron that says God will bless you for me, Aaron. You hear that? I can't laugh well. Let me laugh. But it's so true. Will you keep quiet? True. Where is that coming from? You will not believe some people. The day they got their job, that's the day they start respecting their pastor. Pastor, I drink tea every morning.
Coffee.
You know, look, you might be laughing. May it not happen to you.
Amen.
I'm not, as I'm talking, I'm seeing the image of the person I'm talking about now. Which, thank God we walked. Thank God we know. Say, Pastor, you don't understand. Even you understand. How much are they paying you? That's how you see some people, they are working earnestly for survival. That was never God's plan. If you are working tooth and foot and nail to survive, it's not God's plan. I can tell you, I have proven it. I have proven it. I am, by the grace of God, richer than when I was working. Richer. By the grace of God. It's not about the work. When you are serving, and me, I'll never even start to pipe my pipe properly. You don't know it's a pipe. It's a pipe. When you plug into heaven's supplies, I promise you to never run dry. My brokest of days is some of you's richest times. And I'm not boasting anyhow. My broke, when I say I'm broke, some of you will say, sir, give us that broke. Let's have that broke. Look, it's not by running up and down. It does not come because I'm older than you. There are people older than me that is broker than you. So it's not about age. It's not about if you grow older, you'll be richer. It's life. You can be older and be broker. I'm telling you. And my own wealth self is not just even in cash. I have multiplied it in resources. My phone numbers alone, the people on it. Not the one that I just have his number. That we talk. That's what purpose can do to your life. It makes you become way more important than money. Look, when I say I'm a man of means, I know what I'm saying, sir. I'm a man of means. Why am I saying this to you? And as I said, I never started to pipe my pipe well. Now, this, like I've said, should make everybody go back home and check. Yes. Even if you're doing well, go back and check.
Yes, sir.
Never think a message is for other people.
Yes.
You are like that Pharisee.
Yes, sir.
That you think that this one is a sinner. What is her they are talking to? It's you I'm talking to.
Yes, sir.
It's you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Look, I will be watching out going forward from tonight. Don't behave anyhow around here. I took a lot of time to sweat. I will know your response to this message from your behavior. Let's rise to our feet. Let's give our offerings. Let's take our offerings first and close the service. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Emi o manyo, emi o magbe oga, iwo sha ma shatile. Do you know the song? Emi o magbe oga, emi o manyo, emi o magbe oga, iwo sha. Do this one. Oh, Lord of time. One more time. Alright, I hope we have the account numbers of the church. Is it coming up? Alright, it's up. We'll be giving. It's our month of much more. Praise God.
Hallelujah!
I want you to go back and check your message notes from January. What did God promise you? Or what did you promise God? Do a recount. On Sunday, we'll start properly this journey. It's a series. I'll be taking you through it. It's going to be very explosive. And it's a series towards productivity. I listen to what I'm saying. I'll be talking about productivity. I'll be talking about what?
Productivity.
Invite your friends to it. Now, some people have given themselves only to productivity, not spirituality. It's also wrong. Because at some level, when you are productive, you will meet with demons.
Yes,
that you need spirituality to handle. Now, some people have just gone spirituality, not productivity. When you go to spiritual, you will soon be hungry. You see what I'm saying? So what I'm telling you is the balance. Purpose will make you have everything simultaneously.
Yes,
you will be healthy for your purpose. You will be funded for your purpose. Your purpose will secure your future. Your future will secure your eternity. So, purpose is it. That's why that scripture says, and we know that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. Loving the Lord and according to his purpose. Are we together today?
Yes, sir.
Things don't work together just because you are just there. You love the Lord, we agree. But are you called to his purpose? Not your purpose. Not your purpose, his purpose. He wrote it there. Don't change Bible. Don't wish Bible was different. I am that person who asks questions from Bible. Why is this one not working? Why? Are you listening to what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
And let me just say this to you. If you are not feeling very well in your body, don't say using medication is of the devil. Medicine is not working against God. The same thing God wants to achieve is what medicine is trying to achieve. Healing. They are not working anti each other. Just like saying, somebody saying that if God is my God, I don't need to go outside and go and walk. You will suffer. Walk is God's method of showing your worth. Did you hear what I said?
Yes, sir.
Walk is God's method of showing your worth. A man's walk is his worth. If you are not walking, the Bible says you should not eat.
Yes, sir.
Bible.
Yes, sir.
1 Thessalonians 3:10.
Yes, sir.
Let's give our offerings and our tithe. If you are casting your tithe tonight, please step forward. Let me pray with you. Anybody casting this or a tithe, please step forward. God bless you. I want you to be believing God as you are coming forward, though. Eh? Not for ordinary things, but for big things. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
I want to trust God for big things. Trust God for touch of his finger on your finances. I want us to pray. On this altar, I want to see millionaires. I want to see people rise from this level of their finances and change in glory, from glory to glory. Please pray. Pray that prayer right here. Go say Kratos Ubegajalaba. Say a word of prayer. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
I call your finances blessed.
Amen.
As you stand before this exalted altar to pray and commit yourself in generosity towards God's kingdom, I pray that God will commit himself to you.
Amen.
The Bible says God loves a cheerful giver. As you give to God tonight cheerfully, may cheerful things begin to announce itself in your life.
Amen.
I pray that the angels of this commission will stand by you.
Amen.
You will not lack substance to
Amen.
Give. Your voice of generosity will not go down.
Amen.
That it will be from one level of glory to another level.
Amen.
Be blessed.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
God bless you. You can take your seats. God bless you. Please, let's give our offerings to God. I believe in tithing. I believe in a God that blesses and makes rich. I believe in a God that leaves us to have sufficient. Are you listening to what I'm saying, please? I want you to insulate yourself from, you know, wrong philosophies or dangerous teachings around and all that stories. You know, there's the website is, you know, and I want you to please don't walk in anger towards anybody. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
Don't walk in bitterness towards anybody. Are you listening, please?
Yes, sir.
One of the proof of maturity is that you are forgiven. Yes. Yoruba says something very strong. I like it. He says, Agba Manba. I like that a lot. You know what that means? Agba. Omanba. Willie, do you understand? Do you understand? Do you understand? Do you understand? Okay, Agba means elderly one. Alright? Elderly person. You know they hear? Willie, they hear?
Yes, sir.
If you see a proper Yoruba person, just say it to him. They will respect you, sir. It's not a common adage. If you see and if you say it well, but if you're not sure, are you listening? Just see an elderly person, maybe where they vex and you want psycam, just tell and say, Agba man ba. He go behave himself. Because that thing is a call to respect. That means, sir, behave yourself. You have said it in a way that is like respect. Agba man ba, sir. Eh? Anybody you tell, as I'm even saying, them will adjust. Agba man ba. Yes. Say well, you're not the one they will think you are doing incantation. Eh? My sister, do you understand? Do you understand that Agba man ba? Have you ever heard it before? Stella, have you ever heard it before? You now heard it before. Who else does not? Are you Yoruba? You are Yoruba now. Do you understand it? Agba, who else does not understand Yoruba? Look up. I'm just teaching you something that is common. Okay, you can hand sound now. Which other, yes. Eh? So, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
It's a very, when they say Agba man ba, that means that the elderly person, the senior person, allows the other person. It's like saying, you are older than this guy now. Agree. Do you understand? It's not because the person is not wrong or something. It's not because you can't slap him. But when you say Agba man ba, he's like, let it go. I'm telling you, it's very powerful. When people upset you, and let me tell you something, the closer you are with people, the closer they will upset you. Are you listening to me?
Yes,
don't fall into that trap of offense. If you know you can't do without them, run away from them. That is dissociated. If you know you can't do without them, stay with them and just know that, okay, for a while, I will suffer it to be so. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Don't let people be taking the energy of your future into anger. It is not wise. I'm telling you as your pastor, use that energy for productivity.
Yes,
and please don't waste your time talking to people that will not listen to you. All right, now, so let's give our offerings. If you have your offerings, please raise it up to God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask that as we give, we are blessed in our generosity, and let this act of faith, oh God, and this show of love produce a harvest of testimonies.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
All right, praise God. Yeah. Let's do our givings to God. How many of us were blessed on Sunday again? Let's just confirm. That was a good one. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to try my best to start our church annual convention next year.
Yes, sir.
Yes, and we'll also start. Let's give the Lord a round of applause. And we'll start a program where it's like, it's going to be a special program, a word conference. I call it exegesis. It will be a session of the word. So I have a release in my spirit that it's about time to start to project myself some more of the things I'm teaching and some of the things I'm saying in secret. All right? And we'll trust God for the budget next year. It won't be anything too loud. It will be straight worship and word. And then we close the meeting with a welcome. And that'll be it, okay? Very straight, succinct, 3 days meeting or 2 days or 1 day. It will just be straightforward. Exegesis. I used to do it long time ago, all right? But I'm just bringing it back. You understand? So it's beautiful. At that time, it was a talk show. But this will not be talk show. This will be word. Amen. And I have a leading to start to bring those my sessions back to the public. And not only limited to the church. Is that okay? So
yes,
if you're a part of it, that's what Virtues International Ministry does. Those things that are separate. This is my personal money. If you give me this one, I will pray for you spiritually. This one is Zenith Bank of Virtues Christian Center. This one is dollars of Virtues Christian Center. That one is Naira of Virtues Christian Center. Do you understand?
Yes,
just in case somebody's asking you what is it all about. So the difference is that this one goes into my pocket. So you don't ask me, Pastor, I want to bless you. It's my pocket, that's my money. If you bless me, thank you. God bless you. This goes to the ministry that does those type of programs. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
There are other accounts. So, sure, you know that church needs money.
Yes, sir.
Hope you know that church work,
yes,
is money.
Sir.
Yes, because it's about society. Start with the venue. It needs money. Just start with your venue first. Let's not even go for your venue for any meeting. It's money. They went to a venue which recently they said the venue is 2.5 million. I said, where? When they showed us, I said 2.5 million. For what? It is 2.5 million. There's nothing you can do about it. Without chairs, without tables. 2.5 million. When I looked at the place, I said, what? Let's go, John. But it's because we didn't have the money. You know, if we had the money, we would have said. So that's what it's about. Have you given here? Let's rise to our feet and close the service. I wanted to pick a neighbor this evening and prophesy on that person. If your neighbor is not prophesying, please change the person. All right? Amen. Amen. You are kicking me, or you know, we'll stay as a family. Oh, yeah, pick your neighbor, pick your neighbor, pick a boo. Start to prophesy. Lord, we speak upon your children and your daughter. Let there be light upon your path. Let new favors start from tonight. Let new directions begin. Show your will concerning the next levels of life. Let there be a inward realignment. Let it shift. Let there be transformations of colors. Let there be light and sparkles of light. Heavenly Father, let it be. Let the inspiration start from afresh. Understanding of the gods, of the books, of the readings, of the Bible. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
I said, in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Does anybody need 1 more minute to finish what he was trying to say? I want to give you another 60 seconds. Wrap up your prophecy on that person. Let's clock completely properly. 60 seconds. 60 seconds. So take shall it be.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Let's say the closing church together. Grace and peace.
Grace and peace be multiplied unto us through the knowledge of God our Father and of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Somebody feels good about that prophesying,
right? Yes, sir.
Did you feel the power of God flow through
you?
So shall it be in Jesus'
Amen.
Name. Before you make that mistake, God will deliver you.
Amen.
Say to your neighbor, grace and peace.
Grace and peace be multiplied unto you. To the knowledge of God your Father and of Jesus Christ your Lord.
Stand upon yourself finally, please.
Grace and peace be multiplied unto me. To the knowledge of God my Father and of Jesus Christ my Lord.
Let's say our chants.
Chants.
Amen. This boy, you are a millennial. Millennial is, what is it? Zillennial. All right, let's say our virtuous chants. Amen. All right. Am I doing the right thing? All right, let's try this together. Everybody wants to go.
Let people of power, called by his name, 77,000 influential souls, set on fire, a butterfly-shaped cathedral, by the Spirit of God. If you know, you know. The mission is possible. Grace our guarantee. Faith our lifestyle. Wisdom our guardian. Here to better humanity. Everywhere we go.
I see you next time, please. God bless you. I love you all. God bless you. Thank you for coming. Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you so much.